Do you want to hear an interview with that guy that we watched that documentary on? The serious thing? He's on Art Bell.
Is it good?
I don't know. I'm listening. I started listening to it now. He just came on the thing. Would you be interested?
Sure.
Okay, cool.
The 6-inch or 13-centimeter box.
A documentary.
Thrilled and you know, it just far exceeded all of our expectations. That's what everyone said.
Tip of the iceberg, Paul. It's going to grow. It's going to get even more in demand, I think. Let's bring in Dr. Stephen Greer, of course, founder of the Disclosure Project, the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, we call it CSETI, and of course the Orion Project and Sirius Technology Advanced Research. Stephen has been a regular contributor to Coast to Coast. I haven't had him on in about 4.5 years. Stephen, welcome back. How are you?
I'm doing great, thank you. I'm here in Los Angeles and recovering from a great night.
It was, you were very busy yesterday. Very busy
indeed.
Stephen, first of all, good to have you back. And tell me
Thank you. Tell me
a little bit, if you can, about this little, I'll call it a creature, for lack of a better word or phrase, and then we'll get into the serious documentary and then Paula's involvement. Tell me about this humanoid figure.
Yes, well, we have determined, of course, it's a 6-inch or 13-centimeter body. It's an intact body. It is not a hoax. We've done CAT scans and x-rays and DNA testing. It is an actual organism. And it was found in the Atacama Desert of Chile in 2003. I did not see it until 2009 and was one of the few people to have ever held it in my hands. And I knew instantly that it was something very unusual. I can tell you from the report that once we got access to it back in September 2012, about 6 or 8 months ago, and I was able to take a clipping from the right anterior wrist, and we could see there was bone marrow in there. And then we saw the CAT scans and saw the lung, as well as what is the remains of a heart and the chest cavity, that we were dealing with something extraordinary. But it wasn't until we got the report at Stanford University from Dr. Ralph Lockman, who is the world's expert on skeletal abnormalities and defects, and literally wrote the textbook on it. And he said, look, according to the bone density and epiphyseal plate development, which are the growth plates in the legs, this is a 6 to 8 year old human-like being. And to be 6 inches big and 6 to 8 years old, that becomes a positive and astonishing thing, no matter what the genetics show. So the genetics, of course, we don't have a database of ET genetics, and we don't have a database of non-human, but human-like creature genetics. So this is going to be a multi-year genetic research project, but the preliminary results even on that are, quite frankly, somewhat baffling. Although, I have to say, we are all not saying this is ET. We're saying we don't know what it is.
Right.
It's a legitimate organism. And if you go to SiriusDisclosure.com, you're going to see that there is a very large report we just put up, and there's a link to it on our website, SIRIUSDisclosure.com, where we have the actual signed report from Dr. Lockman, the preliminary report from Dr. Gary Nolan of Stanford also, as well as the actual CAT scan images and x-rays that anyone in the world can see. So it's there for anyone who wants to look at it.
And what's so amazing about this, Stephen, as you pointed out, it's 6 to 8 years old, possibly. And for a moment, when
Let me correct you. The world's expert on skeletal dysplasias, as well as the head of the Manchon Clinic in Barcelona, where we did the x-rays, have all concluded it is not a fetus. Now, Siegel at Huffington Post wrote, oh, well, there are people who said it's a fetus that's been deformed. Absolutely not a fetus. And this is from the world's expert. something that is quite extraordinary.
Yeah, whatever it was stayed alive for 6 to 8 years in that very miniature stage, right?
Yes, and what's amazing, you know, I'm an emergency and trauma doctor, and I have delivered premature infants. I have delivered an anencephalic deformed baby that didn't live many hours. I have delivered very tiny infants and been in the neonatal intensive care unit where we have resuscitated the babies. Never have I seen a 6-inch tiny, fragile baby, even at the time of birth, be able to live for any number of hours that would be the size, never mind for 6 years. And you can look, and what we have put up on our website are the growth plates of what humans look like, and then the CAT scans and x-rays of this being. And anyone who has any scientific and medical training will say, look, this is absolutely not a fetus.
Let's bring Paula Harrison now. Paula, you had a chance to look at the documentary last night, extremely well done, something that people in the UFO field strongly need right now. Your reaction to this little creature?
Oh, well, the little creature is part of the documentary. It's woven into the documentary, and it just shows that that there's a lot of anomalies in the universe, and it's important that we look at it scientifically. And what's amazing is that Dr. Greer, throughout it, the whole entire film has a Stanford University crew and their results throughout the entire film. But I think the documentary itself, what it does is it gives a 360-degree look at the UFO field, the UFO cover-up, the government cover-up, the lies that have been given to us and humanity by the powers that be. It has testimony from the Disclosure Project. The little being is just part of an incredible amount of evidence.
That's true.
It's incredible.
Go ahead, Steve.
One of the things I want to point out is that, you know, what's in this film is sort of a portal, not for the UFO aficionados and enthusiasts so much, but for the general public, because, you know, at this premiere, we had some of the largest executives in Hollywood there. We had Matt Bodine there. We had Thomas Jane. We had a lot of A-list celebrities and others.
I know.
We had a large number of executives and high-tech people who have been viewing this weekend. And, you know, I was at Paul Abdul's house, and we were doing a screening.
Did you say Paul Abdul?
Some of the most amazing people in the Los Angeles area there in a private screening with Paul Abdul and myself and Dr. Nolan. And, it's really something where people are beginning to question, my God, what if this is true? What if we have this? And what if there are advanced technologies that are being kept secret?
I think she is a big deal again because of American Idol.
For more than half a century, and what a crime against the Earth and humanity that is. So this is really what we want to do. We want to increase awareness. And I just want to point out that the proceeds of this film are all going into a new energy research fund, because what we really want to do is move from information or speculation into a serious, pun intended perhaps, technology research and development effort where we can put the most brilliant scientists in the world that I've identified over the last 22 years and build up these alternative energy systems that we know and can prove exist.
Well, and
you've got to build them into three dimensions.
As I've known you over the years, Stephen, you have been really working at trying to learn more about these propulsion systems that these apparent craft have been, you know, coming back and forth from, and you're right. I mean, there's no, people think that, oh, they can't get here because they think of it in conventional terms. They've got something we don't have right now.
Well, and maybe Lockheed Skunk Works has it.
Yeah.
And one of the people in the movie talks about how he was at a meeting with Ben Rich, the head of Lockheed Skunk Works, who showed an image of a black disc that was made by us going out into space, and Ben Rich said, we have the technologies and the means to take E.T. home. And he was quoting from the head of the Lockheed Skunk Works, and that's in the film.
Stephen, as you said, you know, you have been a doctor for years. It's been your career. You've left that to pursue your interest now in extraterrestrial intelligence. That's pretty gutsy on your part. What made you do this?
To be honest with you, I realized when it came to me very clearly back in the 90s that the government wasn't going to be able to disclose this information because the government of We the People were being lied to, and most of them didn't know anything about it. That we the people, the citizens, needed to come together. And we said, you know, first I had about a dozen of these military witnesses, then 40, then 100. Now we've identified over 400 or 500 of them. And what I've concluded is that this has to be very grassroots. And you know, people say, when is disclosure going to happen? I said, we're doing it. And, you know, don't think that the President of the United States is, because, you know, it's like Jimmy Carter said, he didn't have a high enough clearance to get read into and briefed on this stuff. So we have to find creative ways to do this. But the real thing that grabbed me, and I have to tell you this, my great love, and I was not raised in a religious family, but my big spiritual experience as a teenager was the great love I had for Earth and for Gaia, if you want to call it. And when I realized that the sciences and technologies and the energy generation systems that could give us an entirely new civilization without pollution or poverty were being ruthlessly withheld by a misanthropic bunch of sociopaths, I just said, look, you know, as much as it's been very painful leaving medicine, but I sort of look at the Earth now that all of us need to view the Earth as needing our help. She's our patient, and we have to heal her and heal ourselves in doing so.
This is an amazing couple weeks, too, for the UFO field, Stephen. Of course, with the release of your documentary, Sirius, and then next week, our old pal Stephen Bassett starts his citizen hearings in Washington, D.C. There's a lot going on here. It's got to be just a matter of time before this really cracks wide open, don't you think?
Right, and, you know, in fact, on the first night of this hearing, so I'm going to be speaking at the National Press Club. This is the 12-year anniversary of the Disclosure Project National Press Club event, 2001. And we're going to be showing the entire film, Sirius, there for anyone who wants to come. Although there's limited seating, and it's open to the public without charge. And what we're trying to do with that is to educate the media as well in Washington and the political folks in Washington. And, you know, there's some people, like there's a very fine gentleman who was one of President Carter's ambassadors, who's a friend of mine who's coming. And I think it's going to be a really important event in terms of focusing Washington on this subject.
So important. Stephen, stay with us. We're going to come back with you and Paula. We're going to continue talking a couple hours here about the Sirius documentary, this little creature, whatever it may be. We're going to be joined in a moment as well with one of the lead researchers, Dr. Gary Nolan from Stanford University. We're going to get his take on this. He has examined this specimen. We'll be back.
Well, I like that he's not sticking with the idea that this is absolutely an alien creature that he found, but just kind of sticking with the science that it's weird, you know?
Well, yeah, but my question was going to be like, well how is the fetus, like, or that baby, relevant to what's happening?
I think since they think it might be an alien, but they don't know.
Right.
And I think that's the relevance of it, is that what it could be, what it might be.
Well, I think it's earthly, and it's an anomaly.
Yeah.
I don't think it has anything to do with, you know, I think they should really kind of step away from that idea and just go with what they know.
Yeah. It's a weird catch-22, kind of like the photos and stuff that are too good. Like, you got a body and stuff, it's like the Bigfoot thing where there's no DNA to compare it to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they said there's a huge chunk of it that's human, but there's a huge chunk of it that isn't.
Mm-hmm.
But they can't identify the other half. And of course you can't, because if it's
alien... Well,
why can't
that be an alien thing instead of a Bigfoot?
No, I mean, this little creature thing.
Well, I know,
yeah.
But, like, why can't Bigfoot be considered...
Oh, believe me, there are some people who think it is an alien.
Oh, what an old classic.
Found
that in his drawer.
But I see what you mean. Why aren't they dragging
that
into the argument?
That conclusion.
Kind of brings back some old memories, doesn't it? Hey, our goal, to make all of you Coast Insiders, members of the exclusive club, 15...
Well, I'm guessing in this case, it's just that this little thing is so inhuman that,
you know, also don't forget to pick up our free apps.
That it feels like it could fit into that.
It looks like an alien that, like, you know, NASA has depicted. All of a sudden,
it literally looks like an alien.
It does. Yeah, right. But that makes it sound like, and with the findings, it just makes it sound like
it's Nolan for a little bit as we talk about this.
A wild speculation.
Yeah, no, you're right.
Spending some moments here with us. I appreciate it.
I'm delighted to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
You would love to prove that the creature is human, but as far as what you've done so far, are you pretty well convinced whatever it is, it was once alive, or it was once a real type of a biological specimen?
So let me actually, just in a good way, correct the first thing there that you said, where you said I'd love to prove that it's human. I don't want to prove that it's human. I think that it is very, very, very likely to be human, and I want to really get to the truth of the matter.
Fair enough.
And when I entered this with Stephen and his team, the idea was certainly not to come in with any presupposed expectations of what it would be, and that through the study, I would attempt to leave no stone unturned in the analysis of this. Now, I think that to this point, the data that we have is basically pointing as strong as possible, or as much as you could imagine at this point, that it is human. But as I relayed in the film, and as I've had discussions offline with Stephen, when you have something which does not really conform to expectations, you want to make sure that you do leave no stone unturned. And in the case of this, where we have DNA which is perhaps left over in the analysis because of the way that the computer programs are designed, we want to make sure that, as I said in the film and otherwise, we're not throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Now, this creature, 6 inches tall, speculation that it's 6 to 8 years old. Can you confirm that?
Yes. So, I can't confirm the age. I can confirm what the time that I spent with Dr. Lockman going over the analyses of the x-rays, what his conclusion was, that it was most likely to be 6 to 8 years old. What you have really is a paradox, right? You've got a specimen, a presumed young child, let's say, let's not go unearthly at this point,
okay,
that is
start looking at the bone density, the first frank issue is that the bone density, irrespective of the epiphyseal plate, tells you that there's something a little bit odd, right? And so I'm, of course, not a specialist in this, but when Dr. Lachman, who is a specialist, looked at it and he pulled out the standards that he uses and that people would use in forensic analyses of these, of, say, a dead child found, let's say, the surprise was, and it was his conclusion, certainly not mine, that the epiphyseal plates would suggest that it was 6 to 8 years old. So here you have a contradiction.
It sure is. Well, look, here's an example. You know, I've got a little 5-year-old grandson.
Mm-hmm.
He plays hockey. He runs. He's 5 years old. He talks. He's about 3 feet tall. And, you know, he does whatever a little human being does. So are we saying that this creature was alive when it was around 6 or 8 years old? Keep in mind, my grandson's 5, but it was 6 inches tall, so it's possible that it was walking around and doing things, but it was that small?
You go ahead if you'd like.
Yeah, what I want to comment, because I'm a clinical doctor, medical doctor, is that when you have the epiphyseal plate presenting as they do in the bone density, it does require that to be, that it be somewhat ambulatory, and it is developing its long bones being the legs and arms and what have you. So, you know, we can't say, well, we know for a fact it was walking around and this and that, but the reality of it is that it's not a fetus. And this brings up exactly what Dr. Nolan's mentioning, and that is, how do you square the circle where you have a 6-inch intact organism that is absolutely not a hoax? And I think that Gary will agree that this is a biological organism.
It is absolutely not a hoax.
So it's absolutely not a hoax. And the world's expert in these skeletal matters says it's a 6 to 8-year-old. And then keep in mind that other radiologists, such as Dr. Manchon in Barcelona, who runs the Manchon Clinic, has said that it absolutely is not a fetus and that it lived for some years because of the bone density and the epithelial plate. So this is not
a fetus.
Never been done to age a specimen this young. Standards
control for progeria, you know, advanced aging of bones, or the known forms of dwarfism, and you're not finding anything.
Right. No, there's no mutations there. And but again, I think there's another thing that the listeners should really appreciate is that mutation in genetics is a very strange thing. There's always another strange mutation around the corner. There's always another one-off combination of mutations that could occur to cause a given disorder or disease. So just because I don't find a set of genes or one or two genes that might be suggestive of being the disorder doesn't mean that, again, it has an unearthly origin.
Gary, in terms of the skeletal composition, how old is a human fetus got to be to have that kind of skeletal composition as we find in this creature?
I actually wish I could answer that. That really is something that for Dr. Lockman.
Okay.
It's just not my area. I'm sorry.
Stephen, would you know?
Well, it's the size in terms of length of perhaps a, you know, 15 to 22 week fetus, depending on, you know, what condition it may have, which is a very, you know, pretty early a fetus.
Lastly, what can you tell us about the head? The head portion seems elongated.
Right, but I mean it seems elongated, but there are, you know, upon drying, for instance, there could have been something that went on with the bone plates. You know, again, all I know is that again, when Dr. Lockman commented on it, he did not comment it on it in a way that suggested he knew what the genetics was that